So last time on Exploring the Unknown, Tabby Star, we talked about the Kepler Space Observatory, and that was a probe, photo-sensitive probe, that looked at a small patch of sky. Only roughly about 150,000 stars. And what it does is detect over long periods of years, up to a long period of time, up to years, because we're trying to detect actual periodic orbits of exoplanets around stars other than our own, of course. And one star that we particularly found fascinating was in 2011, discovered by Tabitha. Where's her name, Tabitha? Tabitha. Well, I'll find it at some point. Tabitha and her motley crew of astronomers discovered this uneven dip in brightness, and it ended up being periodic, ended up being roughly every 750 days, which is certainly in line with a planet, as our planet takes 365 to orbit. And so I kind of teased you last time with what it was that we discovered about Tabby Star. I kind of just mentioned it and left you hanging. So we're going to pick you up, pull you in from that cliff, and the only place you're going to fall is to sleep right now. Let's get started. So it was astronomer Tabitha Boyajian, and now we call it Tabby's Star. So we missed it in 2015, we observed it again in 2017, and we're waiting for another observation, but tonight, we're going to explore just what it could be. We're gonna speculate. Do what all bad scientists do and speculate. But we're gonna make it a hypothesis. We're gonna make it an informed speculation. And the first question we're gonna ask is, what natural phenomena might explain this? Before we jump to aliens, megastructures, and Dyson swarms, that artificial alien constructions, artifacts, architecture that might have absorbed so much of the actual sunlight between its star and our planet that we can actually detect from. And where, how far away is it? How far away is this star? I forget. But nonetheless, the nearest star is Alpha Centauri, and that would have been, that's 4 light years. It takes light 4 years to get there. Star is. Okay, I found that we did not talk about that last time, so I'm sure we'll get to that. It's a pretty big article, and there's lots of information about it, so we know it's too big to be a planet, but an object actually doesn't have to be very massive to block that much sunlight, any more than your curtains have to be heavier than a bowling ball just because there are blackout blinds or curtains. Gas and ice, therefore, were some of the first speculations about this very interesting phenomena. They're very small but very bright after all, and so they can block a lot of light. A lot of gas can be emitted if a comet just happens to be orbiting periodically close enough to the sun. Do some quick calculations. Yeah, it could be a comet. And they could have a huge plume that has been released once upon getting close enough in proximity to the sun and heating up with a big old comet plume. Or alternatively, maybe a collision of planets actually sprayed debris everywhere. And now remember, we've only seen this twice. So for instance, a big comet coming in from deep space could have been spotted as it approached, and 750 days later as it left. And it could have been a whole wave of comets that were perturbed in some way by a large body sweeping around the outer solar system. But in light of new evidence, since this little bit of the article was written, it's been observed again, so we know it actually is a periodical orbit. So Tabby's star does have a red dwarf star about 800 AU from it. And for relative comparison, Pluto is about 1/20th of that distance at 40 AU, and Alpha Centauri, which is 4 light years, is over 300 times further away at around 250,000 AU. So, wow. So really, it has a red dwarf star only 20 times further away from it, its star, Tabby's star, as Pluto is from us. So, that's a very plausible source of the sort of disruption that can cause a big deluge of comets and debris spread out by the star stays decently clumped on timelines of, couples of years. And again, the first dip masked 15% and the second 22% of the star's brightness, total brightness. So an expanding wave of debris kind of receding away from the star and more diffuse would account for the observed phenomena. Just like that from two planets colliding, possibly. Now, such collision ought to be incredibly rare, so that it would be weird to look out and actually see one. And again, remember I told you, it's already incredibly rare that we are able to have two, and you know, we like to think of it as a roughly two-dimensional plane, the galactic plane that all the stars lie on, and roughly it is, but the orbits of the planets around the stars, such as ours, actually aren't married to that orbital plane of the galaxy, and in fact are, like I said in the last episode, most of our planets, including us, are actually tilted about over 45 degrees, so about 60 degrees, about something like that, relative to the plane, galactic plane. I love saying that, galactic plane. Makes us feel like we're in some universally expansive space opera, which we may be a bit player that we we just don't know the other characters yet. Little tangent. So it's incredibly rare already that we happen to be lined up with the orbital. I gotta stop saying that, guys. I say that way too often. Orbital. Orbital plane. It's incredibly rare. And Drake, I'm sure, would attest to that. So, it should be rare, and it would be weird to look out and see one. That effect of two planets colliding, given that we've only been observing this for a few years, and we're talking about timescales that are over millions and millions of years. So, I guess we really don't know how rare it is, though, honestly. Could happen once every billion years or so. And, you know, we expect the debris to hang around for decades, I guess. So watching 150,000 stars and seeing one is pretty improbable. Probably more probable, though, than winning the lottery. So, of course, they looked for further evidence of either of those, knowing that any big debris field ought to be scattered or scattering light, and it ought to be emitting as much light as it absorbed. What it scattered and reflected plus what it absorbed would equal what it blocked. Yeah. And even comets, which are quite reflective, still do absorb quite a bit of light. Yes, they do. Quite a bit of light. I just realized how much I love calculator sounds. And I hope you guys checked out my bad boy into play. but that's just a little tangent. Let's get back to it. Because, especially in regard to Dyson spheres and the concept of a planet-wide city, like a, Ecumenopolis. I got it, yes. Pronounced it right. Ecumenopolis. Light gets absorbed. Gets emitted as heat. In this case, as infrared radiation in the general zone of about 10 micron wavelengths, which corresponds to roughly Earth-like temperatures. Whatever hits an object in space and doesn't bounce away will warm that object until it reaches a temperature where it's radiating away as much as it absorbs. Kind of an equilibrium point. And it has a peak frequency for it. And a distribution of wavelengths around it that we can actually observe and or look for with our quite advanced photometers, instruments in space. So needless to say, those wavelengths associated to the temperature liquid water can exist at interest us greatly when looking at places where biological life might actually exist. We'd expect the debris to be glowing with all that light and quite brightly as these things go. Indeed, a planetary collision would glow and a lot hotter too, since there's a lot of energy converted into heat in that sort of collision. And the kind we think made our own moon. And you also wouldn't expect an older star to have as many big collisions around it. And you also wouldn't expect an older star to have as many big collisions around it. Those get, of course, less common as time passes and debris clumps together and either gets into a stable orbit or just simply falls into the sun, given that it doesn't get ejected into deep space first. I've heard folks doubt the comet barrage options because of how much would be needed, but I'm inclined to reject that because it really would need to be a huge amount in this case, and I agree it isn't terribly it isn't really satisfactory answer. So this is interesting about how much ice. We don't know how much there is hanging out in deep space near Earth, like in the Oort cloud, O-O-R-T, Oort. Estimates in the Oort cloud often routinely and largely exceeds Earth's own mass, and an awful lot of that mass is actually ice. So it doesn't seem strange to me to think that this larger star might have even more than us in its own Oort cloud, and that having a red dwarf only 800 AU astronomical units away might cause a massive disruption in the Yeah, think about the orbital dynamics of that system. You know, stars are, generally our star is about 99% of the entire mass of our solar system. So it's definitely not unheard of, or improbable to imagine that a star that's only an AU, of course, is the distance. It's a very arbitrary distance, but it's what a lot of astronomers use to measure sub light year. I guess maybe inter planetary systems distances. Because it's the distance between our sun and Earth, us and the sun, or I guess about 8 light minutes. But you can imagine a star, the fact that Jupiter isn't even 1% of what our sun is in terms of mass. Having another star, 800 AU, or only 20 times the distance from us to Pluto, away from it, would certainly perturb a lot of the orbits. It's a very complex phenomena, really. But, you know, I don't know. They're thinking that, so maybe an icy dwarf like Pluto or Ceres, is it, would maybe be dragging a slew of comets around with it, being perturbed by that other red dwarf near in proximity, but it doesn't look terribly plausible. And, you know, a really big asteroid belt could work between the inner and outer planets. Asteroids block more light per unit mass than planets do, actually. I guess maybe because they have more surface area. But, so an Earth's worth of asteroids mass would block a lot more light than a single Earth-sized planet. But you'd kind of expect something like that to be decently symmetric and not a, well, asymmetric blob. And that would cause, you know, a ring doesn't have an orbitable. Good Lord, I need speech lessons. I don't know why I want to add that extra syllable. Orbital. Planet, it doesn't have an orbital period, you know, because it's symmetric and evenly blocks light at any point along its circumference. Yeah. I mean, you could have a partial ring now, you know, a bit of a swarm of asteroids that moved in a pack. And we see that with the Trojan asteroid fields, which I did an episode on probably a year ago. Yeah, probably like a year ago now. And the Trojans, that's really, it's a really fascinating phenomenon because somehow you guys can see this. So, if you guys can see right here, Jupiter, Jupes. We have the Sun in any large two-body system of gravitationally interacting bodies, there's always these fields called Lagrange points. And for some reason, which I don't quite understand, but it's proven mathematically and observationally, empirically, I guess, is another word for that. It's been proven that there's like these gravitational wells at roughly the exact opposite, 180 degrees, and like 30 degrees off. And so basically Jupiter is corralling a ton of asteroids in three clumps called the Trojans. And I don't know where I was going with that, other than the fact that, you know, that could be something that could account for the uneven distribution of, light absorption. But yeah, I'd encourage you guys to look that up sometime, Wikipedia. It's cool, you know, it's not something, and it's different, it's not the asteroid belt, it's actually a clump of asteroids that are in Jupiter's, I guess, same orbital distance. You should play a drinking game every time I say orbitable. Take a shot. So, you know, these asteroids move in a pack due to these gravitational forces. And we see that with the Trojan asteroid fields, for instance. And for that matter, a real big planet like Jupiter could have a really huge swarm of junk around it, sort of like Saturn's rings. And it could be tilted like Uranus, so rings were, you know, perpendicular to the elliptic and blocked a lot of light. So perhaps the rings would be like that, and it would just make the planet's sphere of, you know, area of light absorption relative to us be that much more. So what's left after all these possibilities? Well, a planet forming, so, you know, similar to the aftermath of planetary collisions, two planets colliding, it could simply be a planet that hasn't yet finished coalescing, congealing, also called a protoplanet. It's not an ideal solution either, particularly since the star would have to presumably be a lot younger than it appears. So, but I guess dating stars is actually not that easy, and he says that we often do it by looking at the stars near it, that it's moving with, gravitationally linked to, in some way. That's not always the same thing, by the way. Stars often form from the same nebula and stick together through their movement through the galaxy, but many spin off and packs of stars often plow through other packs of stars, roaming packs of stars, nomadic stars. Some stars are in our night sky have been with us since the sun was born, actually, and others are just briefly passing by. And that's one of the techniques for aging stars, I guess. Dating them is seeing how many other other stars near it look roughly the same age. So, some newer developments though now.
Sure, how old this star is.
But if it's younger, it might be a prototype, a protoplanet that's causing it. Now you can have planets form in a new star's systems that aren't new. And after all, if two ram together, you'd expect some of that to coalesce back into a new planet. And, yeah, we already went over that. And what's interesting is actually the star, they've been looking at old photographic plates, like from when Hubble did it. Again, the catalog name, we're calling it the WTF or Tabby star. It's just a convention. And this thing was found over actually a century ago, so it had a different name long before the Kepler Space Observatory was launched. But they've dug up over 1,000 old shots of it and the field it was in, and they've noticed it's faded since 1890 as much as 20%. So, you know, there's a lot of room for error, but nonetheless, that's tells us that it's probably not a new phenomenon. So it's at least 100 years now that we've been observing it dipping. So we've gotten through most of the dry stuff. Now let's get into the juicy alien speculation. Now, folks often suggest that aliens might use entirely encrypted signals, or not use radio at all, or maybe use lasers that are hyper-focused and wouldn't allow for eavesdroppers unless they were directly, you know, in the path of a signal. Signals, a laser signal's trajectory. Is actually a form of communication among aliens, but if this is an artificial structure, it's not particularly subtle and covert, you know, as he used his metaphor was an elephant blundering down town of a metropolis. Encryption always has a cost, so you wouldn't want to encrypt everything unless you had a reason to. And your reason, if it was hiding a civilization by building a giant structure around a star that noticeably eclipses it in an uneven manner, that's not really the best way to go about doing that. It would be like a sniper for a recon force, sneaking out in the jungle in camouflage, but stopping every few minutes to fire flares. Oh, and sing the national anthem through megaphones. Alright, so if this was a megastructure, what kind would it be? Well, a Dyson sphere can be it could be a swarm or a sphere. It's essentially a spherical, something that spherically encapsulates the entire sun in order to actually absorb its energy. And if you imagine that, how much energy? I think I said it in the Fermi paradox episode, but our planet, just our little planet, which is like a dot, if you had a sphere with the radius of our planet's orbit, our planet would be like 1/1 millionth, or, you know, 1/1 millionth at least, of the, be like 1/1 millionth, and that 1/1 millionth actually gets enough light to power our entire civilization for 1,000 years every day. We just don't harness enough. It's really amazing to think about that. So a civilization would obviously, going back to the Kardashev scale, would be a type 2 civilization, one that's able to harness the energy output of an entire star. So a Dyson sphere doesn't need to be a rigid shell, though. It actually shouldn't be, and wasn't really meant to be when Freeman Dyson came up with the idea. It could be an early stage Dyson swarm that's maybe 1% complete. So, and that's just a series of, I guess you could think of them as asteroids or artificial planets that are specifically engineered and designed to harness light and block, you know, by the simple fact that they're not translucent, they would block, and that their purpose, if it is their purpose, is to absorb the energy from the sun. It would, of course, dim the star. And a Dyson swarm is, you know, on paper, the most efficient way to harness all the energy would be to make a sphere around the entire sun, their star. And so it could be, you know, barely complete. And you might be able to do it in stages by making rings and adding to each ring and then adding a new ring. And it's easier to do it that way since those swarm objects have virtually no escape velocity, and so you need almost no thrust to move from one place on the ring to a neighbor. Moving that same ring of orbitals in a Dyson swarm could be accomplished with a spacesuit and a fire extinguisher. You'd expect the home planet to basically be, you know, like a home base for all the clouds of orbiting structures from which they would expand and probably exponentially drop off in number and density. And, you know, that would at first, at least during the phases of construction, so that would drop off as the structure begins, nears completion, but it's asymmetrical dimming of the star would be in effect until the thing is at least 50% done, you'd imagine, right? So, if this is what's going on, that's probably what it would be on Tabby's star. And similarly, you could mine a planet in a similar fashion. You'd expect to see a big swarm of orbital and megastructures near a planet you were strip mining, and a lot of debris to micrometeors aren't as big a deal when you don't have to spend thousands. thousands of dollars a pound for your space stations, because you can armor them up and surround them with ice and rock. Now, considering the star appears to have dimmed in the century we've been observing it too, you could have a fairly symmetric distribution of overall. Excuse me. Except where some planets are that are being stripped down for additional construction material. But here's the big problem. There's no reason to do this around the star. We're not seeing indicators of some sprawling interstellar empire in this region. And again, Kepler was staring at that patch of sky. So a lot of those stars were near or further, but its neighbors were all in that sample. And of course, we didn't observe any other dimming, so unless this just happens to be the very first megastructure ever built, then it's not looking likely. It stretches credulity that any intelligent life evolved around a star whose maximum lifetime is only 3 billion years. And again, while it's probably pretty near the end of that, it might be younger too, and which would make even more unlikely. So that this isn't someone's home solar system. There's no sprawling empire here with other stars exhibiting the same effects. And this gets us into motives. Why would you pick a short-lived star? One probably on the old side and as your one place to start setting up megastructures. You might mine inferior veins of ore or farm not so fertile land, but not until you'd already gone for the low-hanging fruit and there are tons of nearby stars that, you know, would of course be younger and more stable for long-term endeavors such as this. No, maybe they just got there a century or so ago, relatively speaking. And it's 1,500, oh, there we go, 1,500 light years away. Light years away. So what we're seeing now in terms of dimming in the last century is really about around the fall of the Roman Empire for us. It all took place when the Roman Empire was falling. Islamic Empire was emerging. But it does seem a stretch to think that this is either A, someone's home solar system, and they evolved very fast compared to us, or B, the sole place they've decided to do this, or C, one of the first they did, and the only one we can so far see. Now, I don't think he mentions this in the rest of the article, but of course, along that same line of thought, it just made me think that if they take 100 or so years to construct, or maybe even 1,000 or 10,000, perhaps they already have multiple megastructures and Dyson spheres around other stars that are so complete and uniform in their mass and density that there would be no way for us to detect any observable dimming of the star, because even if it as a whole was blocking a percentage of the star's light, even a significant percentage, it would be uniform. So due to its uniform, so perhaps
this is a megastructure, and it's just the one currently being built. Now, mostly, because even with they were full-blown Kardashev 2 plus solar star harnessing civilizations, it's implausible that they could be this close to us in space. 1500 years, light years isn't that far compared to, you know, 150,000 light years. That it's within less than a percent of the galactic diameter from us. So, it again would be quite the coincidence. After all, if one civilization developed 1500 light years from us, then if we drew a bubble of space 3,000 light years out, with double the radius, and therefore 8 times the volume and 8 times the stars on average, you'd expect 8 more planets to have birthed technological civilization on average. And 1,500 light years is really nothing in galactic timeline. So it would be strange. One of those 8 not to have much longer head start, especially since this solar system, if it was their home, a tabby star, would imply 3 billion years is enough to become technological compared to our 4.6 billion. So, in summary, I don't see much odds for this being a megastructure. You know, A, because it seems pretty likely that it's a natural celestial phenomena, and B, because it just doesn't fit the bill for what a megastructure would theoretically look like and appear to us. So we didn't solve any riddles of the universe today, but we did have some fun exploring the hypothetical observations we would encounter if we were really that near a Kardashev 2 type 2 civilization this close to us. And even if not, it's still cool to observe possibly a artifact of a planetary collision so large that it's dimming a star 1500 light years away from us. So I don't know, that's really all there is to it today. Hope you guys enjoyed this little exploration, and make sure to smash that calculator button, or that like button, I guess. I don't know, either one, doesn't matter. And yeah, just let me know what you guys thought of it. As always, I love your feedback, and I appreciate your subscriptions, and all my Patreon supporters, PayPal contributors. As always, you guys encourage me to keep moving forward and keep thinking of new topics, and you give me great ideas too, so I'm just blessed, and I'm grateful to have all you guys watching this.